Hi everybody, can you hear me? Okay. My name is Alan Hansman, Director of the Townsend Center for the Humanities. Welcome to this beautiful room for what I think will be a great conversation between two distinguished guests who are wonderful writers. Just let me thank a few people. This is an event co-sponsored by the Humanities Center and the Arts and Research Division. And I want to thank Shannon Jackson, the Vice Chancellor of Arts and Design, for taking part in this and helping organize it. And also, a little bit behind the scenes, Lauren Pearson and Rebecca Egger and Colleen Barroso. So thank you all. I also want to thank especially Scott Saul, who will make our introductions of our guests. This series is inspired by a course that Scott is teaching now. Scott's a professor in the English department on nonfiction creative writing within the Townsend Center sponsored program called The Art of Writing, which is meant to teach great writing across a range of styles and disciplines and to celebrate great writing. So I should also say that Scott is one of the great writers that our faculty is honored to host, not just the kind of work that 12 other people in the subfields read, but even books that somebody who, like me, read before I even knew that Scott was a living person. Like his first book, Freedom Is, Freedom Ain't, Jazz and the Making of the 1960s, which I read before coming to Berkeley. And then recently, and maybe more pertinent to the conversation today, Becoming Richard Pryor. And there's also a great website associated with that. So I'll just leave it to you, Scott, then, to introduce yourself. Also, I should mention, Scott has a podcast.
That's true. And for people who have missed this event, it will be turned into an episode of the podcast.
Yeah, you should check out all your episodes. They're great. Right. So thank you.
Well, thank you both for coming.
It's my pleasure to introduce Jeff Chang and Hua Hsu, two writers who, as the country, our country, has been rocked by a resurgent white nationalism and has been buffeted by the energies of the Black Lives Matter movement, there are two writers who have been, I think, among the most lucid and sane guides to the world we live in. In several ways, Chang and Hsu have shared parallel paths to this library, this room, this event. Both Chang and Hsu are Cal grads, undergrads here. Chang was here in the mid-80s, Hsu in mid to late 90s. Both are critics endowed with what musicians call big ears, the ability to hear outside the usual categories and make new sense of what they pick up. Both have written about the music of the underground as well as the music of the mainstream, and both have written about the political stories that never make it into the spin cycle of cable news, as well as the stories that dominate it. They also share a great finesse as writers, and I can easily remember the first time I read a piece of theirs. With Chang, it was the fall of 2005. I was teaching a course in the cultural history of Los Angeles and looking for a better way of framing the emergence of gangster rap when Can't Stop, Won't Stop, a history of the hip-hop generation, you see top left there, magically fell into my hands. The book seamlessly wove together stories of deindustrialization and ghetto entrepreneurship, social protest and aesthetic innovation. Somehow it managed to combine a historian's sense of social structure, a biographer's sense of psychology, a journalist's sense of storytelling, and an activist's sense of urgency. And you'll say it soon popped onto my syllabus. Chang followed Can't Stop, Won't Stop with another ambitious, large-scale history, Who We Be, a cultural history of post-civil rights America, which traced how artists of color created new stories of national belonging and new forms of cultural protest in the wake of the civil rights movement and in the face of resistance from educational and cultural institutions. Last month, Chang released the already acclaimed We Gonna Be All Right, Notes on Race and Resegregation, which I would endorse as the best primer on our current political crisis. It's the result of Chang's reporting around the Black Lives Matter movement, as well as the result of 3 decades of thinking on these issues. I should note that Revolution Books is here, so we have limited copies of the books of Jeff Chang and Hua Hsu to buy afterwards. Note that. Chang currently serves as executive director of the Institute for the Diversity in the Arts at Stanford. The first time I met Hua Hsu, it was January 2009. I was still feeling the buzz of the election of Barack Obama when I turned to the cover story of that month's issue of The Atlantic, titled The End of White America? Question mark. Right there. To get my bearings on the world that Obama's presidency might usher in. The End of White America was like nothing I'd ever read in The Atlantic. More nimble, more hip, more attuned, It began by evoking the white panic of Tom Buchanan from The Great Gatsby, and then it considered how Sean Combs had become the Gatsby of our day and age. It analyzed how hip-hop had changed American culture, part of a larger shift toward the multicultural and multi-platform. It translated the insights of whiteness studies for the general reader, and ended by wondering what would happen when whiteness, perhaps the category of racial identity itself, was no longer at the center of our social structure. It was brilliant, heady stuff, connecting far-flung dots into a mesmerizing pattern. And who was the essay's author? A graduate student? How had this grad student created this incredible essay? My mind was blown. I kept my eyes peeled for more writing by Hsu, and he is obliged by writing luminously for the last decade on music, politics, sports, and books for Grantland, Slate, most recently The New Yorker, to which he contributes on a shockingly prolific basis. And that's one of the great things about Hsu, is that he writes a lot, so he satisfies my hunger for his writing. An associate professor of English at Vassar College and a board member of the Asian American Writers Workshop, Hsu is also the author of the just released Floating Chinaman, Fantasy and Failure Across the Pacific, which you can buy and get signed after this event. So please join me in welcoming Jeff Chang and Hua Hsu. So this is how this event's gonna work in terms of format. We are gonna talk for about 45 minutes, 50 minutes. And we're gonna start by talking about writing. This is an event that's sponsored by our writing program. And then it's gonna open up to Q&A, and then the book signing, there'll be reception, food, and drink, and so on. So maybe you can, I wanna start by having each of Hua and Jeff talk about a particular piece of writing of theirs, a particular section within that piece of writing, to think about what dilemmas do people face as they're trying to write into the world of politics, the world of culture. So we'll start with Juan. You could read this for people, talk about where it comes from, from your white plight.
Oh, you want to read it?
Yeah, I think it's nice, you know.
Before I do that, it's so awesome to be back. I graduated in 1999, and it's incredibly meaningful for me to be back at Berkeley, so that's a God. I'm not that happy to be speaking in public, or to be thinking about awful things. But so this is the end of a piece I published, a couple months ago. And it was a review of three new books on sort of whiteness in the American imagination. So white people interested in exploring this refashioned identity are realizing what people with allegedly minority presence long ago discovered. That these categories are more often than not placeholders, spaces of aggregated meaning, where the expectations that come with being told who you are rub up against the aspiration to figure out what you might become. The question is whether whiteness, having arisen from a set of privileges accrued and institutionalized over centuries, can ever truly become a minority category, even if white people become a numerical minority. Whiteness was once described as invisible, a conspiracy that could never be brought into focus, but we can now at least contemplate the possibility that white might become a color like all the rest. This is what it would mean to enter into history rather than simply bending it to your will.
That's a great last line. And you mentioned that you, to me, or emailed, you care a lot about opening and closing lines. How did this passage get shaped maybe in dialogue with your editor? How did you come to that last line?
Sure. I'm pretty obsessive about the first and last line of everything I write. I have this terrible habit of, when I think of the first line, I think that I'm 80% done with something, and then I procrastinate for the next 11 hours. Before in the morning, I realize that I still have 1,700 words to write. But it's really important for me to figure out where a piece begins and ends. The reason I picked this isn't because I love the paragraph or anything, but it was a piece that took a lot of negotiation with my editor, and I think that's something that you rarely experience nowadays. Even if you're working as a journalist, it's rare to find editors who are as hands-on as this editor was, and I think part of it was just the delicacy of dealing with the subject matter, and also I think for myself, there was a matter of where I would enter into the piece. I don't actually enter into the piece in the first person, but I did sort of intentionally use you twice, and one of them was sort of me, and then the other one was sort of directed more at a general reader. And whether or not anyone picked up on that, I didn't really want to force the point, but that was something that we really negotiated back and forth a lot about, sort of the use of pronouns and who was being addressed in the last line. And this was also, I should also say, this was a piece where I had exchanged about 2,000 words and emails with my editor before I even wrote the first word of the piece, which was really unusual, and it really helped corral something that could have easily kind of spooled into an uncontrollable mess. So maybe it is the best, but
not at all. It's a great piece. I'm curious how much the fact that the New Yorker's readership is kind of like a, you know, fairly affluent, sure, largely white.
Yeah.
How that played into, you know, your sense of audience, your sense of how you wanted to intervene and write this piece.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right about the perceived readership of and probably the actual readership of the magazine. So, is this too? This isn't too like inside baseball to talk about readership. I think what I didn't want to do was just to caricature or lampoon the sort of working class subjects of two of the three books, because I think it's very easy for a publication like the New Yorker or sort of publications of that strata to descend into caricature. So it was sort of important for me to recognize that was sort of the spirit that people might enter into the piece with, right? That we were just sort of going to identify this thing if only to neutralize it by making fun of it or by condescending to it. So I think that there's a lot of work that went into the piece. I mean, this is 300 words out of a 6,000 word piece. And there were a lot of moments where I just wanted to be really careful that no reader would feel too comfortable in the observations, or no reader would feel sort of not somewhat complicit in what was being described. Does that make sense?
No reader would not feel complicit, so that everybody is some role in this kind of social system that is...
Right, like I mean the readership of the New Yorker, yeah.
So at the end with that, you know, you do have the you, right? When you say, this is what it means to enter this, rather than someone bending into your will. So it's a bit of... That was kind of it.
Yeah, I guess you could read it that way, definitely. That reading is available, and that was intentional. But it wasn't meant to be accusatory, because I don't feel as though that was the purpose of the preceding 5,000 words, but that was just sort of a way to bring the reader back into this thicket of ideas.
What I am impressed by, but others, how it manages to both be very pungent, but not accusatory. You know, and that balance is not the easiest thing to achieve.
Well, maybe it would help to contextualize. The piece begins, like many pages earlier, with this really famous photograph from the sort of desegregation photograph of that ended up winning many awards and became sort of this placeholder for how people understood notions of white rage in the civil rights era. So that initial photograph was one which a lot of people across the country saw, this sort of young, angry white woman yelling sort of young obscenities at a black woman going to school. And it became this source of great empathy, right? A lot of people saw it and sort of tried to relate to it. And so I think I was trying to trouble that sense that we could just sort of slide into, you know, empathizing or just sort of thinking as though we had resolved things merely by feeling better about our present.
Let's hold on to that, that kind of in-betweenness. Mm-hmm. I think it might be a good segue to look at the piece that Jeff wrote, a passage from your recent book, a chapter called The In-Betweens. Maybe just situate this chapter, what you're kind of doing it, where it fits in the larger book, and we'll talk about this passage.
Sure. Can you all hear me okay?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Good. So first of all, my heart's kind of beating through my chest right now. Because I just remember this was my favorite room when I came to Cal. I would spend a lot of time here listening to records and just reading books and generally avoiding homework. And so just to be back is, I mean, I still live in Berkeley, I know I work at Stanford, but all of you should feel happy that I'm actually making my students read three or four times as much as I would make you read if I was teaching here, as we are getting back in there. So I'm getting it in from there. I could just get lost in nostalgia right now.
We'll go there later.
Yeah. The book is it's called We Gonna Be Alright, Notes on Race and Resegregation. And it was built around these two essays that formed the middle of the book, about Ferguson and about resegregation as the frame to kind of understand the current sort of ways in which we can see race collectively. Who We Knew is about how we see race individually, and it led me to kind of a lot of the questions that I further unpacked in this book. And it's a thank you note in a lot of respects to the Movement for Black Lives, because Who We Be came out in September of 2014, about 2 months before the killing, the murder of Michael Brown by Officer Darren Wilson in Ferguson. And so much happened from that particular point to now. So it began as a way of trying to forge a new introduction for the paperback edition. But it came back as 50 pages, and my publisher was like, nah, it's not interesting. So, but it's a new book. So if you can put it together in 3 months, then let's go for it. And I said, okay. And I knocked it out in 4, because I still don't meet deadlines. But it was meant to be a thank you note in so many ways to the Movement for Black Lives, for being able to push these issues that we as a nation have so skillfully sometimes avoided for the last 5 decades, and certainly even during this Obama presidency. And in doing that, I knew that I had to do an essay that would explore my own kind of personal positionality, as Ron Takaki used to put it. As a Chinese and Native Hawaiian person who grew up in Honolulu, Hawaii. So this essay is the second to last essay, it's called The In-Betweens, and it's about Asian Americanness, and trying to explore this weird kind of place that we occupy between blackness and whiteness, between sort of complicity and freedom. And it was a very difficult essay to write. I wrote it in second person. I used you. We can talk a little bit more about that, because I really was struck by the way you used you. You, the contrast of we and you was super interesting to me. And this is actually, you selected a part of the essay that means a lot to me, but which hasn't necessarily been talked about too much amongst folks. So, do you want to read it?
It's
hella long. Everybody read it already. Well,
okay, it has a kind of rhythm to it that I want to hear.
I love it. Okay. The category of Asian American sprawls. Sixth generation toddlers and undocumented teens. Crazy rich co-eds chilling on Rodeo Drive and in Singapore Air first class. And couples on public assistance packing their meager belongings under eviction notices. Architects and ecologists, nannies and bus drivers, seamstresses and factory bosses. Class divisions that reflect the displacements of the Cold War and congressional preferences for the not so tired and not so poor. Innumerable histories colliding even in a single family. Yet here you are, the evidence of American warfare and familial risk and survival, making yourselves through pan-ethnic coupling and an emergent culture of image, story, song, food, a tiger clan, a model fucking minority, a blueprint for multicultural democracy. Sorry, I just swear. You two are the exception and the exceptional. When you are summoned, you too may teach the rest of the world exactly how to get along. What does it mean to be the evidence that racism is not real? To be fetishized by colorblind liberals and white supremacists alike? To be so innocuous that teachers and policemen and figures of authority mostly allow you the benefit of the doubt. to be desired for your fluid, exotic, futuristic, yielding difference. What does it mean to be the solution? For you, the Du Boisian question is turned upside down. It haunts you.
The Du Boisian question, what does it mean to be the problem?
Yeah.
And you mentioned before you read us that this was an important passage to you.
So
maybe if you just dilate on that for a
second. The last part, the last question, what does it mean to be a solution? I wrote that line, I think, about 10 years ago or so, maybe longer, when I was asked to, another moment where my heart was just beating outside of my chest. I got a master's degree in Asian American Studies at UCLA, and I was asked to go and speak at the graduation. And I was thinking a lot about it at the time, of what it meant for us to be getting degrees from elite universities, and to be at the same time wanting to go out and change the world, and the kind of privileges that many of us brought in are the privileges that certainly many of us are going to walk out into, and I think that made me think a lot more about the souls of black folk. I was part of the generation that came of age with the Los Angeles riots, and I was in the first class at UCLA that came in after the riots. And so the riots colored, I think, pun not intended, but maybe, I don't know, colorized like pretty much everything I've written about and done since, from Can't Stop, Won't Stop, all the way up through. And so, you know, this particular paragraph was to try to talk about how difficult it is to kind of summarize Asian America, despite the fact that everybody always is, and to be able to kind of get at the sort of diversity of what's happening in that, that's still boiled down to, you know, go back to your own country, like folks are telling Michael Luo or Mia Hua in the street, or many of you, right? And to try to think about that at the same time that we're thinking about, you know, racist love. This notion that Sumi Cho reintroduced to me, like Sumi Cho was a grad student when I was an undergrad here. She's now a law professor at DePaul, of what does it mean to be kind of fetishized, to be put up as a model, and especially to be done so in the face of sort of reactionary, a reactionary way of looking at race, as sort of a lesson, a haunting lesson to other immigrants and to, especially to Native folks and black folks. And so that's sort of where I came to this last part. And I rewrote this because I realized absolutely it's overdrawn, and I could think of a million ways in which you know, these things are not happening. These questions are you know, we're not innocuous. My brother has been racially profiled by police, even though my mom worked for the police in Hawaii, and it happens all the time to my cousins, my family, my friends. But I realized that I needed to kind of write it from that sort of extreme in this particular paragraph in order to make the case.
Well, one thing I really love about it is that, you know, just as like a social movement raises new questions that people have to address, opens up a conversation. I feel like that's really what this passage does for me, is that it kind of paints a broader canvas of all this complexity, and then ends with a series of questions that are left kind of hanging in the air. And the point is not necessarily to answer them, because they're, many of them are almost unanswerable, but to force other people reading your book to wrestle with them. And I wonder if that was kind of the point you kind of raised, you know, all these kind of series of questions, then you just end with that very quick, like, it haunts you. Because to me, that set the tone for everything that follows in that essay.
Yeah, and the piece in the sort of part in the essay that kind of people most pick up on is the, maybe I should talk around it because I'll be giving away the punchline, but sort of the intra-Asian American ideological battles And I think that here's kind of where I took a cue from Hua, is that it was much more important for me in this particular essay to explore the ambivalences than it was to kind of explicitly state what my political position is. Although I do, but to kind of interrogate and allow the other side to maybe have a position in order to be able to get at this question of diversity in Asian American communities, but also to be able to reinforce, I think, my own kind of moral and ethical position about how Asian Americans should address being in between. And it's obviously not to land on the side of complicity, but to land on the side of liberation.
And this kind of generousness with which you allow the kind of public antagonist to have the room to speak, in, as opposed to you shutting her down because you have more power in the space of that story. Well, may I shift gears a second, because I think it is important that this is a homecoming for both you guys at Berkeley, and I'm curious if we could just explore, how do you think, and this is a big question, but how do you think Berkeley shaped you as a writer to be the kind of writer who would both be, on one hand, you take on very big political questions, but you also explore them, I think, in a way that feels open. So I'm just curious if you feel free to riff on, ways that Berkeley, you feel like it really left its imprint on how you write.
First of all, can we cover the...
Yeah, please do.
Thanks, we're done.
You just shut it down.
Just had it. Thanks. Yeah, there are a lot of super personal things that I get into, but I think just at a very general level, Berkeley was, at least when I was a student, it was a place where you had your lessons in the classroom, and then you had sort of the lessons outside the classroom. And you were always responsible, not necessarily for squaring the two, but for thinking about those connections and the frictions, So I ended up very randomly being a political science major. I minored in Asian American studies. And I was always thinking about the sort of practical applications, or just sort of what a lot of these ideas look like in real life. And I know that sounds kind of banal and basic, and that's sort of the point of college, but I teach at a college now, and I don't think that's necessarily baked into everyone's college experience. And I think that
these conversations matter, and that you're dealing with these kind of things are rippling onto the campus.
Yeah, not just that they matter, but that there are places right down the street where you can think through these ideas and sort of act on them and embody them. So I know when I was a student, I was really interested in writing. Like, I made my own zine that I would sell at bookstores that are no longer here. But I was also doing sort of like activist work or sort of mentorship work. And I feel like that, even though that didn't help, that wasn't something that forced me to think about the craft of writing. It made me feel as though I never wanted to address just a single audience. Like, I wanted as many people as possible to read what I was writing. And maybe my parents don't feel as though they're the audience for what I write, but I think as an academic, but also as someone who writes journalism, like, I've always wanted to just toggle between registers, or just to sort of mediate between different worlds of ideas and sort of action or art. So I think that was something that I tried to embody as a student, and then that's sort of a sensibility I take to writing. Does that make any sense at all?
What were the different audiences that you imagined, when you were writing those things on campus? Trying to bring together, have a conversation where one wasn't existing before.
This might be way too specific, but I think the things I was learning in this political theory class I took with the late, great Michael Rogan, a lot of those things were really in conversation with stuff I was taking in ethnic studies classes, but these weren't necessarily, but they were completely different kids in these two classes. And so that really intrigued me, and sort of like how certain knowledge becomes, seems more legitimate in a certain setting than others. So I think that was a really formative experience.
That's like an example where, political science, I think, probably has a lot more power institutionally here.
Yeah, definitely.
And yet it could really benefit from the kind of questions being asked in Asian American Studies.
Yeah. But
Jeff, you want to get a back at that question?
I just sort of remember, I went to a smallish kind of school in Hawaii, and I came here, and Berkeley was so sprawling, and everybody seemed to know so much more than I did, and I felt like I was basically in the deep end and I was swimming, but what really helped was I was able to find communities of folks very quickly, and the thing that I will always value about Berkeley is the intensity of Berkeley folks, period.
And you're not referring to Stanford, I don't
know. I'm not referring to, well, actually, Stanford is very a very intellectual school. And this is no knock on Stanford. I think that Stanford folks would feel the same way, but Stanford is a much smaller school, and there's much more of a prevailing sense of collegiality, and you sort of don't stir the waters and that kind of thing. Or if you do, you do it in a very kind of, gentle kind of way.
You can disrupt entrepreneurially.
Yeah, disruption is a big word, but this place was disrupted to me like every half hour. Antoinel, like seeing Smokey like doing his stand-up comedy to whatever rally was on Sprawl that day, to going back to the dorm and getting into an argument about El Salvador. Like it was always disruptive, and the intensity that folks always brought, I will always value, and I've always sought actually through life. I've always tried to duplicate that kind of sense of community. We were just talking about this earlier. Paul and I were part of this online community that we started in the late 90s of music journalists and music critics, and just going back on it, we had this group that's called Soundings. We kind of changed the world, and then Hua goes, we really did change the world. And if we thought about it a little bit more, like Hua was going on the list of the folks who were in this crew, this little listserv thing, and we were like, yeah, it included two MacArthur geniuses, Josh Kuhn and Ta-Nehisi Coates. It included Hua, it included John Caramonica, it included like Julianne Shepherd, it included Jessica Hopper, it included Oliver Wong, it included all of these folks who, like, and we were always intensely fighting things out, and I've always tried to seek that out. So in that way, that's always going to be an indelible part of who I am, is that fire that I kind of walked into. I use differing metaphors here. I was in the pool and then not in the fire, but, water and
Well, maybe we could switch to talk a little about music, because both you guys are so accomplished as music writers about music. It's hard to write about music, and arguably, writing about music has changed a lot in the two decades since you guys had that. I guess you want to reflect about it. What challenges do you face now writing about music, kind of the age of streaming? How is it different than what it was like to be writing on music in the 90s, so, has the place of the music critic changed because of different kinds of outlets or different ways that music is packaged with other arts forms, fashion, what have you?
Yeah, that's a huge question. I feel like it's obviously a lot faster. It's really pretty impossible for a general music critic like me, who's responsible for writing about all sorts of genres, to keep up with just how rapidly things change. Also, I don't know how many people here actually buy music still, but you don't really need to.
Who here has bought a particular CD or download? In the last month.
That's impressive. I asked a student, a first year student of mine, what the last album she bought was. She said, "Well, I don't actually listen to albums unless they're assigned to me at school." And I thought that's really amazing that now the version of like making someone read Thomas Hardy or something is like, oh, listen to the entire Kendrick Lamar album, But I think that one of the challenges is that every critic has to work through whether or not they view themselves as a consumer guide. And I think in certain art forms, there is that function, right? If you're a movie critic, chances are people are reading your review of the new Avengers movie to figure out whether to go see it. I feel like with music, you don't necessarily need the critic to mediate that relationship anymore, because, you know, with Spotify, with Tidal, with Apple Music, if you're remotely curious, it's probably easier just to listen to it yourself than to figure out whether a critic gives it a 9.2 or an 8.5. So I think, personally, I'm more interested in these questions like, what does it mean now that music is packaged with other things? Or what does it mean that, you know, like, I think one of the most interesting questions about music now isn't necessarily about styles or genres, it's what it means that we no longer have the headphone jack and an iPhone, you know, what it means that the former captains of the music industry, someone like Jimmy Iovine, who discovered, you know, like Dr. Dre, Eminem, and that whole pyramid scheme, he's now in charge of Apple Music selling us headphones. So what does that transition mean in terms of technology, sort of changing relationships to music? And that's stuff that still interests me. It's harder now to kind of find a new artist and champion them in a way, I think.
Like what John Landau did for Bruce Springsteen.
Yeah, exactly. I think you still, as a critic, you kind of want to understand why something new is exciting people, but you're no longer, like, I don't think the rise of, like, Lil Yachty had anything to do with, like, music writers saying this guy is important.
No, it's just, you said Lil Yachty and then Lil Dicky's popped into my head, which is just, that's, my brain is not functioning. No, I know,
sorry.
No, I know, it's going to be a hard time getting that out of my head. For me, in terms of writing about music, I worry that some of the art of it is gone because of the lack of venues that are paying for it. I think that part of the reason that we lived through, I think, a very privileged era was that, you know, the music industry, again, soundings is happening in the late 90s. This is the peak of the music industry, like billions of dollars, insane junkets to Jamaica all the time, you know, are happening. And we're kind of in all of this, but there's a whole infrastructure cross-generationally where folks were getting training in really good writing. So both Juan and I have been, like, mentored by some of the best in the business. Bob Criscow is not only the sort of one of the greatest writers ever to have lived, he's also the best line editor that I've ever had in my life. And just that kind of attention to detail, when everybody's getting paid, everybody has a job to do, everybody has a slot to fill, you have to improve. I worry that because that's gone now, that there are no longer the kinds of structures to be able to make that work. So I've tried in my own little ways to build up different kinds of spaces, you know, with my students, and to try to give them the intense line editing, to try to, like, work with them on conceptualization around pieces, to pull out big ideas. Those kinds of things, but it's not like the universities can replace, like, this intense music journalism structure of people from the age of, I don't want to guess how old Criscow is, all the way down to the 20-year-old, but, like, at least 40 years of folks in between helping each other, pushing each other along, having these intense forums where they're arguing all the time, all of those kinds of things. That's what I worry about. Not being there anymore. For me,
because kind of the neoliberal gutting of newsrooms and other magazines has made it so the incentives is to create neoliberalism.
Well, I think neoliberalism, absolutely, but I think just also the idiocy of the record industry, which we could talk about for hours, you know. You can never really underestimate how dumb the record industry is. I think. And I think that the record industry killed the record industry. But that's a whole other discussion, I think, for another time. I mean, for me, it's been good to be able to have still be part of these types of networks. We still are able to gather on Facebook. People are still informally swapping drafts and all that kind of thing. I yearn for interaction and engagement with people who are, you know, under the age of 30 to be able to help folks like understand, explain, and move into a place where they're able to talk about things. I think it's happening in fiction, especially now for younger authors of color who are coming up. And I think universities are going to provide spaces for writing workshops to happen around fiction, for instance, but certainly that hasn't been the case for nonfiction writing.
I just want to reiterate something. So Jeff mentioned this listserv a couple of times, and I remember I think one of the younger people on this listserv, and I felt way more nervous like emailing the listserv than I did as a graduate student in my seminars, because they were just sort of names that I really respected in a completely different way. But I think what I miss about that era, and I feel like anyone my age will always miss something about when they were like 22, is that it was in private. Like, it was a public forum by invitation, but, you know, we were working a lot of ideas out, a lot of sort of unpopular ideas, and it was a community, but it was sort of a bounded community. And that's something, I'm sure there are these sort of public-private conversations going on, but I think nowadays it's a lot easier to just sort of shoot out that first draft and not have sort of gone through the extreme vetting of your community, you know, to use a...
And also maybe we're also more oriented towards publicity, so it might be a Facebook post with lots of commentary on it, but it doesn't have that same boundedness.
Yeah, and definitely, and no knocks on that approach, because I feel like a lot of really great ideas grow out of that kind of sort of public brainstorming, but I do sort of think that the first draft of all the things I do start off in like private G-chats or, you know, just in private conversation. And there just aren't as many spaces like that available, at least in my world nowadays. So.
Let's shift to talking about politics, because you guys have written well about it. And one thing I think that you discuss in your book, most recent book, is how Black Lives Matter movement kind of posed challenges for the media by refusing to have certain hierarchical structures, by kind of being more feminist, queer, in the way that they conceptualize it. And I'm curious how much you guys think that the media has risen to the challenges that the movement has posed to it. You know, I think about how at the last presidential debate, it's happening 6 miles from Ferguson, and basically mostly talked about it, right? Which is striking.
Absolutely.
How do you think shoot that out and see what you guys think.
Well, I think that in a lot of ways, the movement for Black Lives has transformed, not completely, but in part, sort of the focus of major media outlets. This is a weird counterintuitive example, but it's a perfect example. The focus on white premature death, I think, is a perfect outgrowth of the questions that the movement for Black Lives has raised.
Attached to the Trump campaign in terms of thinking about
Even before the Trump campaign came out, the New York Times, there was a study that came out a few years ago on the rising suicide rate amongst white middle class families, particularly among women. And I don't think that study would have gotten any kind of play, but for the fact that the Black Lives Matter movement has brought into question the entirety of this notion of life expectancy and premature death. And so it's counterintuitive in some ways, but in other ways it's sort of a perfect example of how the media moves towards a race conversation and then digresses in other directions. So I feel like it's always easier to, for another example is this current campus debate, debate about campuses around trigger warnings and safe spaces. I was just at the University of Chicago last week. This is a debate that starts because students are walking out in protest on over 100 campuses across the US to protest the lack of diversity amongst faculty, staff, lack of mental health professionals of color, lack of the kinds of infrastructures that we were asking for when we were students.
And I was a student in the 80s,
in the 90s. Right, and going back to the late 60s. And 50 years later, here we are. Same demands, same types of things, and the media diverts or digresses this kind of conversation into a conversation about, oh, these students are suppressing free speech and freedom of expression. And so I think that those are two kinds of ways in which the media has not met the challenge that's been posed by the Movement for Black Lives. That it's been able to push us back into these sort of old familiar culture war types of arguments. I mean, that whole freedom of expression thing was happening when I was here. That was part of what I was sitting in Morrison Library to avoid. You know, it was like, oh my God, I can't deal with this, all this noise. Let me put on this rare Olivia Smudge album, right? To kind of get away from this type of crap. And so, you know, I think that that's part of what we need to be able to do to push, continue to push the media around these types of questions. I think, though, that the media has done, for instance, a good job in other respects. For instance, The Guardian has a whole special ongoing thing called Accounted on its website, theguardian.com. The Washington Post, in some ways, has forced, and The Guardian in that way, have forced the FBI to start looking at collecting these kinds of pieces of data around policing incidents. And so it's happening in some kinds of ways. And I think too that the din around questions of resegregation is rising, thanks to the hard work of people like at The Atlantic, at CityLab, who have been kind of pursuing this, and dogged reporters like Nicole Hannah-Jones and Wesley Lowery, who are out there, who are doing the work, and who have been like pushed into spaces of, I mean, Nicole, when she was doing the work back in 2012, went to ProPublica to do it, right? And then the New York Times brought her on to say, we need you to be able to do what you did there for us. And now we've got, I think, a resurgent kind of conversation about questions of resegregation. So it's moving in both directions at the same time.
Yeah, and I think it's put a lot of stress on how cultural critics think about popular culture as well. Like earlier when I was talking about how it's difficult now to purely view yourself as a consumer guide telling people thumbs up or thumbs down, you know, that question is pretty irrelevant when a lot of music that's sort of made in the shadow of Black Lives Matter is so meaningful and so important and so it becomes sort of an organizing tool. So, I mean, just personally, I've spent a lot of this year writing about pieces of music that sort of question the limits of empathy, question limits of sort of packaging protest into song form, wondering sort of what it means. Like, you know, the Kendrick Lamar album from last year was very much resistant to the market. You know, I mean, it was popular and successful, but it also felt like a very thoroughgoing attempt to say, like, if this isn't meant to sell, which, you know, like, an artist have always done that, but I think that becomes a really interesting question at a time when sort of racial politics can be so easily absorbed into the market. So, you know, an album like that, an album like Anoni's record earlier this year, which is sort of this climate change dance record. I just find that the music is forcing me to ask different questions of the critic. Maybe 10, 15 years ago, I would have thought, isn't it beautiful that a sort of multicultural cast of listeners can rally around this piece of music? Now I sort of sometimes wonder, is that, what do we do now? Like, is that sort of all there is? Is that sort of the point of this song? I don't necessarily have answers, but just sort of a new set of questions that I think the moment is sort of placing stress on the act of criticism.
Can I add to that? Actually, just to kind of build out Claude's point, I mean, these are albums like Kendrick Lamar's album, more recently Solange's album, where, and then Beyonce's album before that, where they wouldn't have been ready for the marketplace in 2012. People, like, there were companies I'm sure would have been like, what are you doing? But all of those albums went number one and stayed there. And I just think that it speaks to the fact that folks want to have this conversation right now. And I think that that's the moment when critics like Hua are stepping up, when, you know, we as writers, when whatever we do, whether I'm writing books or you're writing posts, blog posts, or you're writing for newspapers or whatever, where we can step up into this kind of a gap. And I think that you know, I've often said that cultural change precedes political change. I feel like what's happening now is that the Black Lives Matter movement has kind of brought that dialectic back around, so that it's made it possible for all of these artists to be able to explore these questions in a really deep kind of a way, in really new, sonically interesting kinds of ways. And that in turn is inspiring, as Paul just described, us as writers to kind of step our games up as well, to try to respond to that too.
Yeah, I mean, just to follow up on that, I mean, think about, say, with Kendrick Lamar, Beyonce. I mean, in what sense, how are they kind of opening up the conversation? Just if you could be a little more specific about it, because I think that it is opening what the idea of what protest music could be to create these kind of, I think you could call it like spectacles of, I wish I could get this, kind of unmitigated blackness or something like that.
That wasn't my phrase.
Oh, that was...
That was a Paul Beatty. I was quoting the author for the piece, but yeah.
And what's the kind of... We want to think about these artists as kind of opening up problems, just as you were doing with those rhetorical questions. How are they kind of... I mean, on the one hand, there's the protest aspect of the music, sure, which is to say, some things are very clear. Premature black death by the state, at the hands of the state, at the hands of the healthcare system, at the hands of the prison industrial complex. All these things are pretty clear. But then there's a world of complexity that stands within those problems. What do you think is going on? You know, what are some of the more complex things that these wave of artists are forcing us to go into?
Well,
that's a good question. What do you think, Scott?
That's my turn to your writing. I feel like one thing that I would say about being a music critic is that's hard to be a music critic as you get older. Because in a way, the most intense feelings about music are felt when you're a teenager or in your young 20s.
Right.
I think it's amazing that you guys continue to write about cutting edge music, even as it was passing in time. The investment tends to diminish for a lot of people, but you guys still manage to capture it.
I'm gonna be very general. I think the beauty of pop music for me, or popular culture, is that it's always about a relationship to the world, right? It's about an artist figuring out their relationship to the world. It's about the listener figuring out where they fit in that world. And that can be really kind of dreamy and utopian. And when it's not, you end up wondering, like, why isn't it so? Like, what is being described such that this relationship to the world is very dark, or it's something that should remain undigested? I think as a critic, sometimes I think it doesn't really matter what I have to say about things, particularly when it comes to someone like Beyonce, right? Like, it doesn't really matter if I think her album is good or not. It's important, you know? And I think it's more interesting for me to think about the importance and sort of how more people use the term intersectionality now, or more people sort of have learn about books to read or arguments to make that spin out of that album than it is for me to kind of figure out whether I think it's good or not. Does that make sense? And that's a different kind of relationship to the world and to the art that I'm sort of discovering.
it's less about personal taste and more about like, well, what is this thing? What is this work of art? And how does it ask to be explored?
Yeah.
And how, what kind of questions does it ask? What kind of resistance do we get when that relationship between harmony and noise, for example?
Yeah. I think when I was a student, I a transformative moment for me was reading the critic Rail Marcus, who came to my History 7B class and gave this really wonderful lecture. And I don't necessarily like everything that he writes about, but he would always convince me why something mattered or why something had to be created in that moment. And that's sort of the question that I think the current moment to raise again. Like, why are these things being created? And I think at its most modest level, that's all I can hope that my criticism does, is help someone think about. When I wrote about the Kendrick Lamar album, I wrote about it alongside this incredible novel by Paul Beatty called The Sellout. And my only intervention was just to say, if you're into this album, read this book. Usually music critics, we review albums in tandem, but it was sort of like, no, there's something bigger going on here. I'm not arrogant enough to think that I know what that thing is, but both of these artists are touching on what Beatty referred to in his book as this notion of unmitigated blackness, like a blackness that was insoluble to commercialization. So, I mean, I think as a critic, that's all I can do is offer these juxtapositions and say, here's a way of thinking about why this thing exists.
Yeah, I really relate to that. I mean, I think part of our job is to be the documenters and to kind of explore the intertextuality of things in ways that kind of help to illuminate the current moment. Because we're always, I mean, the thing about criticism is that the criticism is, of course, happening. It's implicated in context here. It's happening in the moment, right? So, in a way, our job is actually just to be able to capture that moment, to be the photographer that's capturing that moment, in words, I suppose. So I was thinking about your essay there, and what I was trying to do with the Lemonade essay in We Gonna Be Alright was to connect Beyoncé to what Carrie Mae Weems was doing and to what the late great Grace Lee Boggs was talking about as well as Robin Kelly and other folks, Brittany Cooper and other like fellow sort of critics. So an artist, an organizer, philosopher, every person, Grace Lee Boggs, and then a number of public intellectuals. And to think about Lemonade offering, like if you read it in this way, a sort of narrative of transformative justice, which is kind of crazy and mind-boggling, and maybe a huge leap to make, but that's part of the job that we have to do, I think, as critic, is to be able to say, hey, actually, maybe this is going on with this. And then our readers will say, oh, you're crazy. You know, it's just about her and Jay-Z, or whatever, you know, but to be able to kind of like draw these kinds of threads out that maybe help to spawn more discussion and maybe deepen those kinds of discussions in different kinds of ways.
I think you've definitely done that. I want to pause now and shift to you guys, the Q&A, because there's a lot of questions you have for these two wonderful writers. I'll go for Max.
Alright, thanks so much.
I'm still in awe that there's just so many people here.
Yeah. And thank you all for sitting here and being so kind. And
the novelty of being back is not yet worn off.
So. It's been really fun to listen to you, and you were just getting to the stuff that I really wanted to talk about here toward the end. But I run the chapter about Lemonade, and I was really convinced in a lot of ways by your reading of it. But I also was, in the back of my mind, I was thinking about the bell hooks,
yeah,
critique of it, and this whole idea that we were just talking, that you were talking about in reference to commodification. Mm-hmm. And so I was wondering about, like, how do you sense what the critic's role is when the end of white America could just as easily be the beginning of kind of equal opportunity commodification as it could be the opening of this conversation. So So I was just wondering, how do we, as people that are interested in intervening critically in these conversations, how do we like introduce the political economy element of it as much as we are kind of celebrating culturally how it feels?
Sure.
Jeff, you've
written
a lot about cultural equity.
Yeah, cultural equity and political economies for sure. Questions of access and representation and power. And what I want to really be careful about how I say this, because like so much love and respect is due to bell hooks, who have also been one of the folks that I was reading here in this room as well. But there's a way in which the argument can close itself off to anything new, you know, and the reality is,
can you explain what the argument is?
The argument that I'm gonna butcher this argument, so I'm gonna try to argue it in a different kind of way. There's an argument that can be made in cultural criticism when one is moving towards dealing with political economies and structures, that it's always going to be this sort of reductive kind of argument that, well, it's all a commodity anyways, so it actually doesn't mean anything. Like, one can't be really serious if one is putting out their art for sale. And I think that if you take that argument to its ultimate end, it's actually very anti-art, and it's very anti-artist. Because artists have to live in a political economy too. And so for me, I would rather take that in as part of a list of ways in which to approach this particular kind of subject, right? But not necessarily try to box myself into this position of having to defend a completely anti-artist point of view, right? Are you saying, would one argue that one should never create art because one needs to actually sell it in order to actually have food to live? I don't think that one would actually take it that way, but that's one of the ways, the really reductionist, vulgar way that argument can go, right? And so I would much rather play with the toolbox of saying, here's, yes, that's true, it's a commodity, right? And yes, it's also true that the commodity may be doing some work around here to open up our eyes or open up new possibilities of other things that could be happening. I think it's a much more interesting position to write from. And I think it doesn't negate the approach of being able to expose political structures. And the reason I came to this is because I for many years, would have this argument with my students or younger folks about hip-hop. And the argument began like, oh, well, rap is just like misogynistic because they're all getting paid to rap these kinds of to rap these kinds of lines, right? And that actually allows us to be able to get away from questioning where these misogynistic attitudes and ideas came from, and it also forecloses the possibility of transformation and agency for the artists, right? And so I wanted to kind of move to a position that would allow for students to be able to say, maybe the artist has agency here, right? And if they have agency, then that's actually maybe a much more difficult thing to unpack, right? That we would have to really acknowledge the depth of the misogyny strand, misogynistic strand that's happening here. And then we would really have to confront the political structures of it. And then we might have to actually think about like what transformation of all those kinds of things might look like at the same time, right? And so for me, I just find that it's a much more interesting way of analysis to be able to come at it in that kind of a way, to be able to force all these questions open up at once. If that makes any sense.
Yes.
I teach English at Laney College. It's a community college I'm from. And my students are really inspired by the chapter from Can't Stop, Won't Stop about the gang truce in LA. And I know it's an old book, but I think it's kind of pertinent to this conversation. It's very relevant to my students to think about gang leaders and residents of, you know, housing projects as being like political leaders. But that chapter kind of ends with the Million Man March, and just the reporting you did is amazing, very unique, you know. So I've had trouble finding information about what killed the gang truce, and if you had any thoughts or any leads on stuff that I could read or assign a student to look for about.
Oh, that's a great question. Yeah, and I definitely hear that. There was so much back in the day that could be, you know, brought up and stuff. You know, there were police campaigns in local police departments and as well at the federal level to actually work at surveilling these leaders, right, and putting pressure onto them. And you know, and sometimes things got just deep in the communities as well, and folks kind of, you know, backstabbed in some ways. And so many of these stories, I would encourage you, and I would encourage you to tell your students to go and talk to their folks about it. These are community stories that are out there, and that you're not going to find in the San Francisco Chronicle or the Oakland Tribune or the Contra Costa Times or any of that stuff. You're gonna find these from the storytellers in the community, you know, who live on the block and kind of hold those kinds of histories, who are the keepers of that kind of knowledge. Well, one of the big passionate things that I have is that in that regard, it's the methodology should be for us to be able to recover those kinds of stories directly from the folks who live them. And then to treat those stories with a sense of responsibility. So that people will ask me all the time, are you mad about the Get Down? And and I'm like, I can't be, really, because these aren't my stories. The stories that I put into Can't Stop, Won't Stop are stories that were entrusted to me in so many kinds of ways. And the best thing that you can do is, as a teacher, as a writer, to be able to retransmit those kinds of stories so that they are able to live on for another generation. I mean, the main point I was trying to make is that every time there was a community piece that formed, there was a creative explosion that followed. So that the gang piece in the Bronx led to the explosion of hip hop in that borough. And that the peace treaty in Los Angeles led to this creative explosion that actually propelled hip hop to the top of the charts in the late 90s. And so, yeah. Thank you for the question.
Hi, well, first of all, thank you for this conversation. It sent my brain spinning really happy thought, so I'll try to stay focused on my question, which was inspired by snatches in this conversation, so I'll just try to reconstruct it. Hua, you were saying at the very beginning that, you know, your editor was really hands-on with you in this piece, and which, I haven't read the whole piece, but the blurb was beautiful. I'll try to go back and read the whole thing. And then Jeff, you also said something about how difficult it is to summarize Asian Americanness, even though everybody already is, and I relate to that. And I come from a literary criticism background, and so the word representation is everywhere in activism, and certainly in literary criticism. And I was wondering if, you know, speaking of how artists are generating new questions for critics to focus on. I was wondering if, like, one of them is just an irritation with this interest in Asian American identity. I don't have an exact quote, but in Hua's blurb, there was that line about how being told who you are rubs against who you might become. And I wonder if in between there, for an artist, there is one more kind of you know, friction, which is the imperative to represent who you are to people who clearly are very interested and don't know, or, you know, just, I guess part of that is voyeurism, but it goes deeper, because if your editor keeps telling you to write a story about who you are, even if you want to write about something else, then, like, so, yeah, I was wondering what you thought about imperatives upon artists to represent
as Asian Americans? Well, that's a great question. So imperatives of Asian American, placed on Asian American artists, I feel like that's a question I've been trying to unpack for like 20 years. I'll start by just talking about myself, because I think that Jeff and I have had a lot of conversations in the past couple days just about the subject position of being like an Asian American writer who, and I don't think either of us write mostly about Asian American things. Like I think I frequently do, and that's usually because I feel like at The New Yorker, for example, there aren't that many other people who will take on these stories. So it's not really a burden of representation that's foisted from without, but it's something that I feel like, well, you know, someone might as well say these things. And I do think that it's a strange, I'm not going to say burden, but it is this weird dimension of the experience that you have to think about that. And I think that it's made me more, that you have to think about how you'll be received as an Asian American, particularly if, you know, we write about race a lot, we write about hip-hop a lot. Bearing in mind how someone will read that story in light of who we are, it sort of gets baked into my approach, I think. And it's made me, I think, more sympathetic to not presuming that I understand sort of what an artist's responsibility is to their community. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Like, I think maybe when I was an undergrad, I felt like I should support every Asian American artist. Every Asian American artist had a responsibility to represent their community. Now, I still feel as though that's true to some degree, that that's just sort of baked into who you are. But I think I'm less rigid about it because I've sort of moved through the machine myself. I've had to kind of negotiate these questions of being an Asian American writer, but kind of sneaking that identity into my pieces in ways that 99% of people who read them won't recognize. You know, like the piece that Scott put up, The End of White America, after Jeff read it, he said to me, that was a really Asian American approach to the question. And I was like, I don't know what that means. And he said, well, in order to talk about citizenship, you reference like Ozawa and Thind, like these two landmark cases around American citizenship that involved Asian immigrants. I said, well, that was just sort of my approach. But I guess examples like that are moments where my identity does enter into things. So I don't know if that answers your question.
Kind of.
Right.
I mean, I think you talked more about it, which
people. All right, cool.
I appreciated your comments about the evaluative aspect of criticism, whether something is good or bad, and how it can be, or how I can see it at times to be a distraction. But I wonder if it's so easy, if it's as, I'm not saying you were saying this is easy, but it's hard for me, and especially at a time when political works, artworks, music is forgiven a lot of the time for merely being political. And I wonder to what extent you can actually separate successfully the expression of a work, both its effectiveness and its affectiveness, from its meaning. And whether that can actually happen, and whether surely in a place like the New Yorker's critic at large column, where one is given a lot of freedom to veer from the works being discussed, to use them as a starting point, I don't think that's true with most criticism, and I think folks are required to take a stand. And the stand they usually take, I think, the default is often that because it's political, it's effective. And I'm not sure that's true.
Yeah, I don't think that's true either. I think it sort of goes back to the initial question for me, which is, I think I like reading writing that shows its work. So, for example, if I didn't write about Lemonade, but on one hand, I thought Bell Hooks' criticism was interesting, right? It was a really useful way to critique the critique sort of how we consume political music nowadays, right? So I think it's important, like I agree that there's certain anti-artist aspects to, it becomes a bludgeon, but I like criticism, I like reading that shows its work, that sort of struggles with that question, and I think if I were writing about something where I had an ambivalence about what it was, but I was certain about its sort of impact or its importance, then I would sort of foreground that tension. And I think that's where, because you initially used the word feels, like how it feels versus sort of understanding and recognizing like the structure of capitalism or whatnot. I feel like being able to toggle back and forth between saying like, this feels good, but there's something else sort of going on here is fundamental to like how I would approach something like that. Does that make sense? But yeah, I think there is a way in which even criticism that is like even the most sort of woke forms of criticism are still sort of susceptible to not being able to pan out from the current political cultural moment. And I think it's incumbent on critics to kind of recognize that.
I'm going to ask one last question, maybe a quick question. We have one of the people who's organizing the Trump teach-in tomorrow at noon. It's happening on Sproul Plaza. Yeah, Trump teach-in.
Yes, tomorrow, noon, Sproul Plaza, Savio Steps.
Yeah.
Trump teach-in. We have 6 faculty speakers.
So I want to, pivoting on that, I want to ask you guys, because you've written about the larger histories of race in America, what about the rise of Trump has surprised you, and what has not surprised you? We'll take either side of the question.
Surprised or not surprised?
I think that when I wrote that piece in 2009, it was about, it wasn't my title. The point of the piece was just, regardless, I wrote it before the election. So my editor said, regardless of what happens in November, the rise of Barack Obama will change something about how Americans understand race. And one of the things, one of the threads, I think if you read that piece, it's not clear how I feel, because I finished a summer research not knowing how I felt, you know, and I think a lot of things I write have that sense of like unease, right? And but one thing that someone said that I've really held on to is just how the language and the sort of posture and the genre of identity politics, which would sort of migrate from marginalized group to sort of white identity, and it's been really fascinating to see that really happen with this election. I mean, I wrote pieces the past 2 weeks about, 1 week it was about dank memes and sort of Trump and memes, and then last week it was about this sort of alt-right art show, and my mentions were like wild, terrible. But it was really fascinating to just see that a lot of the criticism I got, which trafficked in a real kind of like 1800 racism, was also sort of couched in this language of identity politics, sort of like, I have my identity, you have your identity, don't try and like describe me. So it's just been interesting to see that sort of, which, you know, Tea Party was an example, that really kind of coalesce and become like an actual identity. So surprising and not that surprising.
Yeah, it's interesting. We're talking about this a little bit, I think, just in terms of how resurgent this sort of regressive kind of white identity is. There was an interview that was done, that I did, that Salon unfortunately titled something like Jeff Chang on the White Racial Apocalypse, and my Twitter thing blew up. I think I just mentioned it like once in like an hour. But the point I was trying to make was essentially the point that you had made in the Atlantic piece, which is that white racial apocalypse is the oldest narrative in the book, right? Like, it's been there, it's at the base of American popular culture, this narrative of white racial apocalypse. It's right there in the Cowboys and Indians story, the Buffalo Bills reimagining of the Wild West. And it's there too in Blackface Minstrelsy. And So I think what I'm struck by in the selection is the utter inability for folks who believe in social justice to be able to kind of come up with a strong alternative. And I think that Bernie Sanders' failure, frankly, around racial justice questions kind of pointed this out. It's that we haven't gotten to a point where we're able to think about and build intersectionality into our mass politics. I think we're doing it all the time and in beautiful and brilliant kinds of ways in our communities and our cities all around the country, but the inability of us to think about intersectionality, to think about like what is a position that allows. I've been tweeting out articles this past week about trying to rethink the white working class. There's a number of writers who are talking about how the media, again, the liberal media elite, are getting the white working class all wrong, in fact. And I think the slide and the shift post Access Hollywood of Trump's numbers, even amongst white working class, especially amongst white working class women, indicates that there's something going on here, right? That it's not simply about this narrative of Trump collecting all of the disaffected voters in Kansas and elsewhere. But I don't think that folks have thought about enough about how we build those kinds of ties up, except for the Movement for Black Lives. And I think that the Movement for Black Lives platform needs not to be seen as a platform that's just for black lives. It's like Alicia Garza says, when black people get free, everyone gets free. And I think that if we look hard at the Movement for Black Lives platform, this is a platform that opens things up for a lot of folks who I've been able to meet over the last year in Appalachia, in poor kinds of white communities all across the country. That's the thing that surprises me, is that even in the face of Trump, that we haven't been able to build that kind of an alternative. And so I think culturally it's beginning to happen. And again, I always believe that the cultural workers are moving far faster than the, no disrespect to anybody who's in law or public policy, but moving faster than the folks who are moving in public policy and the law. But we have a ways to go.
Well, on that note, and recognizing that we still need to get past these usual binaries, I thought I would end by reading the epigraph to Who We Be, which is a great epigraph. It's from a Chiapas folktale retold by some kind of Dante Marcos. This is the Chiapas folktale. The gods were fighting, and the gods were fighting because the world was very boring with only two colors to paint it. That is beautiful. On that note, let's thank Jeff and Claude. Thank you all for being here.